one of the coolest video game series, in my opinion, came to us in 1991 on the Super Nintendo. As technology evolved, so did the series. The series that I'm talking about is F-Zero, and what we're going to do today is explore its history by looking at the home console and handheld versions and show you just how cool this series really is. Originally released on the Super Nintendo in North America in August of 1991, F-Zero is the first in the series of futuristic racing games published by Nintendo. It's known for its high speed and unique lineup of characters. The Super NES entry only had four characters operating four different vehicles, such characters as Dr. Stewart, Captain Falcon, Pico, and Samurai Goro were at your disposal. Captain Falcon is probably more recognizable in and out of the F-Zero series, including a place in the Super Smash Bros. Games. Each vehicle in the game has its own attributes such as weight, acceleration, and speed. The name F-Zero is sort of derived from F1 or Formula One racing, except the vehicles you pilot hover a foot off the ground, or track in this case. As you can see, F-Zero made use of the Mode 7 graphics, the same that you'd see in other titles like Pilot Wings. Simply put, the game is given a quasi-3D look and feel, but it's more than just the graphics that's supposed to impress gamers, even in 1991. It's gameplay. Each time you complete a lap, you are awarded a speed booster. This will come in handy if you happen to be behind, but as long as you're in first place, no worries. The A button activates this temporary boost of speed. Think the mushroom in the Mario Kart series to know what I mean. Now, unlike the Mario Kart games, you're not given any weapons or items to toss at your other opponents. There are dangers that you have to avoid, like landmines and magnets on the side of the track that can damage your craft if you are pulled towards it. There are 15 tracks and a total of 3 leagues to choose from, Knight, Queen, and King. Some courses are relatively easy, others will put your skills to the test. A few tracks are repeats of previous ones, except with a different path opened up. Some tracks are a giant pain in the ass, such as the Deathwind tracks. Now, F-Zero and I have some history, and I know you guys like hearing stories, so here goes. The courses that I mentioned that have shortcuts or an alternate path, a path that's closed in, say, Red Canyon 1 can open up in Red Canyon 2. For years, I kept thinking if I get the right boost of speed and hit the ramp, I can go over that track onto the blocked-off path. Alas, even trying it today, I can't. F-Zero was produced by Shigeru Miyamoto, and while some may think this was the only 16-bit entry in the series, you're mistaken. Into the mid-90s, there was an attachment for the Super Famicom called Satellite View, where you can download games via satellite to be saved on a flash ROM cartridge. Naturally, this is something we didn't get here in the US, hence the only way to play these other games was through emulation. They were called BS F-Zero Grand Prix 1 and 2. This was meant to be a direct sequel since the tracks that are featured are just taken from the first game. For instance, in the first F-Zero installment, you had Mute City 1, 2, and 3 in each of the different leagues. In the BS F-Zero games, there is Mute City 4, among four other tracks similar to their US counterpart, but with the number 2 or 3 added to it. There isn't much to say about the BS games, and no, BS is not what you think it means. This edition was more than likely meant to be played with people across a phone line or some other connection. We here in the States wouldn't see another official F-Zero game until 1998 on the Nintendo 64 when F-Zero X was released. This was a much bigger game than the previous entries. For starters, in addition to the original four racers, there were 26 more, for a total of 30 selectable characters with different hovercrafts. And this time, just for fun, you can change the color of each craft and also decide to adjust the craft settings to have better acceleration or top speed. The one downside I should let you know straight away is the speed booster. Now, in the first F-Zero game, you can use up to 3 of them. Here, each time you use that speed booster, it drains the energy of your craft. This actually requires you to use it either sparingly or not at all, depending on your skill. If you tend to crash a lot on the sides or into other racers, using the speed booster too much or too often will cause your craft to burn a lot quicker. Of course, Time Trial, which I forgot to mention is in the first game, sorry, is but one of the few options available in F-Zero X, alongside a practice session and a death race. In the death race, you'll race around a track trying to defeat all 29 racers in the fastest time. In the Grand Prix, you'll race on 5 different cups, each with 6 different tracks. You initially start with just 3 cups, Jack, Queen, and King. The 2 other cups, Joker and X cups, are unlocked later on. The X cup actually generates tracks randomly every time you play it. They range from easy to hard. And hey, one of the cups even gives you the famous Rainbow Road, which can also be seen in the Mario Kart games. A quickie history now. F-Zero X was actually the first racing game to run at 60 frames per second, even with 30 racers on screen at the same time. The only setback is that some detail had to be scaled back a bit, such as polygon count, detail on the track, and some textures. But really, does all that matter to you, the player? The games have been amazing so far, and we've only just scratched the surface. So stay tuned in future episodes of VMTV for the continuation of our look at the F-Zero series. Until next time!